We are on the point of sources of law. As we have discussed, what is the source of law? That is the origin or from where the law evolves. जिथून लॉ तयार होतो किंवा लॉ जिथून निर्माण होतो त्याला आपण सोर्सेस ऑफ लॉ म्हणतो. एज वी हॅव डिस्कस व्हॉट आर द सोर्सेस, देन देर आर डिफरंट काइंड्स ऑफ सोर्सेस ऑफ लॉ. कस्टम्स, रिच्युअल्स, स्क्रिप्चर्स, सॉवरिन, लेजिस्लेशन, कन्व्हेन्शन, नॉर्म्स, प्रोटोकॉल्स, एटसेट्रा एटसेट्रा. अँड सेकंड पॉइंट विच इज व्हेरी इम्पॉर्टंट टू आस्क इज व्हाय इट इज नेसेसरी टू आयडेंटिफाय द सोर्सेस ऑफ लॉ ऑर व्हाय इट इज नेसेसरी टू स्टडी द सोर्सेस ऑफ लॉ. Because we have to know what is the authority who have issued the law, that is who is the issuing authority of the law, whether the law has an enforcing nature or not. Second thing which we have to ask or understand is whether the authority which has issued the law is a proper authority, is a competent authority or not. And third question is that whether the law issued by the authority is a proper law or is it a weak law. If it is a weak law, then it has to be replaced by a modern law. Therefore, it is always necessary for a jurist to know what is the source of law, because if the source is genuine, then and only the law will be genuine. Otherwise, if the source is not correct, if the source is incorrect, then the law issued by that authority does not have a binding force, does not have that much capacity to catch hold the subject. Then while discussing different sources of law, Dr. C.K. Allen has said the true source of law are agencies through which the rules of conduct acquire the character of law, which becomes the law because of certainty, uniformity and binding force which is there in the rules of conduct. Means the rules of conduct which acquire the character of certainty, uniformity and binding force, it becomes the law through the agency like a society, parliament or a judiciary, or there has to be certain definite authority to issue or from where the law flows. Then according to Lon Fuller, sources of law is the material from which the judge obtains rules for deciding cases. It is the material, means the law is the material from where the law is developed, and it is used by the judges for deciding the cases, that is the disputing cases. Now moving further, we'll see what are the different jurists who have said about the sources of law. John Austin, who is the exponent of analytical school, has said that the sources of law, John Austin, who is the exponent of positivist or analytical school of jurisprudence, according to him, there are three different meanings which is attached to the sources of law. First one is the term sources of law refers to the authority from where the law emanates, that is from where the law emanates, means the sources denotes the authority from where law emanates or generates or creates. Therefore, it is necessary to understand the sources of law. Second thing, or the second aspect which is derived from the term sources, is that it may refer to a historical material from which the existence of rules of law may be known, that is the historical material or a historical fact. Historical material. Definitely each law has its own history, and therefore it is necessary to understand that history to understand the law as such. And the third sense which we can understood from the term sources is that this term refers to cause which give the rules of society the force of law. The causes which give the rules of society the force of law means laws are actually the rules of society, but these rules of society turns into law because of the force of law, the force of law given by, for example, like a parliament, that is a legislation, or by custom, or by equity, etc. Means the rules of society or the rules of behavior or the rules of conduct acquire the force of law because of certain kinds of legislation, custom, or equity. And therefore, for John Austin, these are the different meanings which are attached to the sources of law. And therefore, according to him, these sources of law, the term denotes direct authority, historical documents, and causes for the development of rules of society in the form of law. Then, according to Salmond, then we'll see the views expressed by Salmond in case of sources of law. According to Salmond, there are two main sources of law. Now here, the Salmond has given his own notion of sources of law. According to him, there are two sources of law. First one is considered as a material source, whereas second is considered as a formal source. Now, what is a formal source? He has not defined it, what is formal source of law, but he has categorized the material source again into two subcategories, that is the legal sources and historical sources. Now, these are the different classification according to their own norms. This is considered as authoritative, whereas this is unauthoritative. Legal sources includes like legislation, judicial precedents, customary law, and conventional laws. These are different kinds of sources of law according to Salmond. The historical sources includes the writings of eminent jurists, foreign judgments, or the customs and usages which are there in the society. Therefore, these are the sources of law according to John Austin. Okay, then moving further, now we'll see the views expressed by Keaton. According to jurist Keaton, there are different sources of law. These sources of law can be classified into two broad categories. Sources of law can be categorized into two broad categories: binding source of law and persuasive source of law. Persuasive means which are directory in nature, which are not has a binding force of law. According to Keaton, there are two sources of law: binding sources of law and persuasive source of law. Further, he has made a further categorization that binding sources of law may be classified into three categories like legislation, judicial precedents, and customs. These are three binding sources of law according to Heaton, whereas persuasive source of law includes, according to him, principles of equity, that is the equity principles, then professional opinion, that is professional advice, writings of jurist, then he asserts that in modern times only formal sources of law is the state, means only the state has capacity to issue the law in modern sense, whereas equity principles and professional opinions, etc., they are only considered as a persuasive source of law. They are not binding to follow. Therefore, these sources of law has to be studied in a very categorical manner. Then, according to English view, the sources of law, according to English view, the sources of law are primarily of four categories. First, legislation. Second, precedents. Customs and conventional based on agreements, that is the international agreements, conventions based on agreements or international conventions as such. These are four sources of law according to English view, and these we are going to study. Now we know that in India, as like in English, in India, there are different religions, and therefore in India, while studying the source of law, it is necessary to consider the religious practices and religious scriptures who provides the source of law. As we have said in, for example, Shruti and Smriti, Vedas, Upanishads, Mahabharata, etc. Then Quran, Bible, Hadiths, Ayats, Sunnats, Ahadiths. All these are the different sources of law so far as personal law is concerned. But for this purpose, for the purpose of jurisprudence, we are going to see only these four sources of law. These, that is the religious sources, particularly we study these in a family law so far as the succession, divorce matters are concerned. But here in a modern view, this English view is considered as a modern sources of law, and therefore the modern sources of law are of four categories: legislation, precedents, customs and conventions in international agreements. Okay, then we'll see first custom as a source of law. Custom as a source of law. Now we know that the custom is a historical evidence. Custom is developed in a historical era which receives the social sanctions or the permissions of the society, and thereafter that custom becomes the binding in nature. When the custom starts, or how the custom starts, first the practice gets into habit, then that turns into rituals, then that turns into usages, then that usages turn into custom, and this way the custom becomes the source of law. But the custom has occupied a very what we can say pivotal role in the regulation of human behavior or human custom, human conduct as such, and therefore the custom is considered as a very important source of law. Custom is considered as a very important source of law. Then the custom, according to Dr. Allen, the custom can be defined as, according to Dr. C.K. Allen, custom may be defined as the uniformity of habits. Or conduct of people under like circumstances. म्हणजे एका ठिकाणी जर गणपती उत्सव चालला असेल तर दुसऱ्या ठिकाणी होळी किंवा दसरा दिवाळी साजरी होईल का? नाही. एका वेळी एका ठिकाणी जशी पद्धत साजरी केली जाते तशाच पद्धतीने सगळीकडे जी कस्टम फॉलो केली जाते त्याला आपण कस्टम म्हणतो. इट इज नथिंग बट अ हॅबिट, अँड देअरफोर द कस्टम इज कन्सिडर्ड ऍज अ युनिफॉर्मिटी ऑफ हॅबिट्स ऑर युनिफॉर्मिटी ऑफ कंडक्ट ऑफ पीपल. ऑल द पीपल बिहेव इन अ इक्वल मॅनर ऑर इन अ सिमिलर मॅनर, देअरफोर दिस इज अ कस्टम. Therefore, the custom is nothing but the uniformity of habits. Okay, when people find any act to be good or beneficial, then they use and practice it from time to time. First, any act which is good or beneficial for any person, then people practice that thing. Then that practice gets repeated from time to time. And multiplication of this act becomes the custom. Means, एखादी चांगली गोष्ट आपण सुरू केली आणि ती चांगली गोष्ट सुरू केल्यानंतर लोकांच्या उपयोगासाठी येते असं कळायला लागल्यानंतर लोक काय करतात, हळूहळू तीच गोष्ट फॉलो करायला लागतात. आणि एखादी गोष्ट वारंवार ज्यावेळी लोक फॉलो करतात त्यावेळी ती जी ऍक्ट आहे, ती जी कृती आहे, ही कस्टम मध्ये रूपांतरित होते किंवा त्याला कस्टमचा दर्जा मिळत असतो. अकॉर्डिंग टू हर्बर्ट स्पेन्सर, हू हॅव स्टडीड दी हिस्ट्री ऑफ इंडियन सोसायटी व्हेरी वेल, अकॉर्डिंग टू हर्बर्ट स्पेन्सर before any definite agency for social control is developed, there exists a control arising partly from the public opinion and more largely from the public opinion of the dead. Thus, it is a tradition passing on from one generation to another that originally governed human conduct. This tradition is called custom. Means, according to Herbert Spencer, tradition is the basis of custom. The tradition which is developed by what we can say our ancestors, the tradition which is developed or created by our ancestors, those who are now dead, but still this tradition is followed by we living people for another generation, and likewise this tradition goes on ages, and therefore that tradition becomes the custom, and that custom acquires the character of law or the force of law. For next, moving further, why it is necessary to recognize the customs? That is, reasons for recognizing customs. Now we know that the people are very emotional or sentimental over their customs, rituals, and traditions as such, as we Indians are very well versed with. कि भारतामध्ये आपल्याला माहिती आहे की कशा प्रकारे भारतीयांच्या ज्या संवेदना आहेत, भारतीयांच्या ज्या काही इमोशन्स आहेत, ह्या वेगवेगळ्या सणांशी, वेगवेगळ्या सणासुदीच्या दिवसांशी जोडल्या गेलेल्या आहेत. आणि त्यामुळे जर या सणांच्या विरुद्ध कुठला कायदा केला गेला असेल तर भारतीय माणूस जास्त चिडून उठतो किंवा ती कस्टम सोडायला भारतीय माणूस किंवा इतर कोणीही लवकर तयार होत नाही. आणि जर त्या कस्टममुळे एखाद्या समाजाचा पूर्णपणे बिहेव्हिअरियल पॅटर्न किंवा त्यांचं वागण्याची जगण्याची पद्धत बदलत असेल किंवा गव्हर्न केली जात असेल तर तो समाजाचा सोशलिस्टिक पॅटर्न जो आहे, गव्हर्निंग पॅटर्न जो आहे, बिहेव्हिअरिस्टिक पॅटर्न जो आहे, हा समजून घेणं अत्यंत गरजेचं आहे. तो समजून घेतल्याशिवाय आपल्याला त्या समाजाच्या साठी कायदा करता येणार नाही. फॉर एक्झाम्पल, इन हिंदू मॅरेजेस देर आर प्रोव्हिजन्स लाईक अ सीमंत पूजन, सप्तपदी किंवा मंगलसूत्र घालणे, ह्या ज्या काही आहेत, दीज आर द कस्टम, दीज आर रिच्युअल्स. देन दीज रिच्युअल्स, दीज कस्टम हॅज टू गेट द कॅरेक्टर ऑफ लॉ. ह्या कस्टम्सला किंवा ह्या रिच्युअल्सला आपण ऑल टुगेदर वाईट आहे म्हणून टाळता येणार नाही. जर त्या कस्टम्स किंवा रिच्युअल्स ह्या कुठेही संविधानाच्या विरोधात नसतील किंवा कुठल्याही माणसाच्या जीविताच्या विरोधात नसतील, त्याच्या स्वातंत्र्याच्या विरोधात नसतील, तर अशा कस्टम्सला मान्यता देणं गरजेचं आहे. देअरफोर वी हॅव सीन अंडर आर्टिकल 13 सब क्लॉज 3, व्हाईल डिफाइनिंग द टर्म लॉ, द कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन हॅज क्लिअरली सेड द कस्टम्स अँड युसेजेस विच आर रेकग्नाइज बाय लॉ आर ऑल्सो अ गुड लॉ. ओके, देन वी आर ऑन द पॉइंट ऑफ why it is necessary to recognize a customs or reasons for recognition of custom. When a particular conduct is followed by a people continuously for a long time, then it is called a habit. Okay, what it is here? When an act which becomes the conduct which is continuously followed by the people, then it becomes the habits or a habit. Then this rule of conduct or behavior depends upon the generality of practice. He ji kai habit ahe, this becomes general in nature. Generality of practice means everybody, everyone practice that habit, that conduct. Then the community accepts that practice. Then that community accepts that practice either from their ancestors, which have been dead, and this practice is followed by other living persons. Then the emotions of dead persons, emotions of ancestors has to get respect by the next generation, and therefore this is the reason why we celebrate or we should respect the custom. It is a respect towards the dead persons, it is a respect towards ancestor, or it is a respect towards the purvaj. Purvajan karta aslela adar mhanun apan kay karto, ya rituals kya customs ya generally follow karto, त्यांचा अपमान होऊ नये, पूर्वजांचा अपमान होऊ नये म्हणून या कस्टम्स जनरली फॉलो केले जातात. देन दीज कस्टम्स बिकम्स द प्रॅक्टिस ऑफ रिच्युअल्स, दॅट इज इन रिलिजियस प्रॅक्टिसेस. दीज रिच्युअल्स हॅव बीन फॉलोड इन रिलिजियस प्रॅक्टिसेस अँड देअरफोर दॅट बिकम्स द पार्ट ऑफ religion. Once it becomes the part of religion, then nobody can free from following that custom, and therefore it is very important to recognize the custom as such. Then recognizing the importance of custom in Hindu law, even the Privy Council, even the Britishers has accepted that there are certain rituals which are very pivotal, which are very personal, which are very pious, which are very holy for the Hindu people. These rituals have been provided in different smrutis and shrutis, like Narada Smruti, Manu Smruti, Yajnavalkya Smruti, or in Ramayana or in Mahabharata. Therefore, these rituals, these customs are part of religion as such. Then another reason why these rituals have the conviction or faith in these religious practices, and because of its constant use, it becomes the part of life. It becomes the part of life of that society, and therefore their life without following that ritual, without following that custom, is unfulfilled. And therefore the custom plays a very pivotal role in shaping the life of human as well as the life of society. Their custom, custom che kai prakar ahet ka? Yes, broadly speaking, there are two kinds of customs. First, conventional custom, and second is the legal custom. Conventional custom means the custom which we do follow by our traditional pattern or as a ritual, and the legal custom which is followed in a legal field as such. For example, in India, the only senior most judge of the Supreme Court is appointed as a Chief Justice of India. Actually, there is no rule that only the senior most person will be appointed as a Chief Justice, but it is a custom now. This is considered as a legal custom. And conventional custom is there within the particular society, within the particular locality. And therefore, the conventional custom may be divided into two categories: local conventional custom and national conventional custom. Local means which is related only with the particular society or particular community, you know, local and national conventional custom. Local conventional custom means which is applicable only to the particular society or a particular community or a particular tribe, whereas a national convention is applicable to all the persons who are living in that nation. For example, like a Diwali or a Holi or a Dasera is a national festival of India, and therefore these are conventionally followed. These are the national conventions which have been followed by all the people where they are in India or outside the India. Then the local custom, a legal custom, can also be categorized into two parts: local custom and general custom. Local custom means the same which is followed in a particular locality, and general custom is that which is followed throughout the realm, throughout the territory as such. And therefore the custom plays a very important role. Then how the custom is a good custom? There are certain requisites of a valid custom. Means every ritual, every practice cannot be considered as a custom, but that ritual, that conduct should have certain essentials which has to be completed by that rituals to be recognized as a custom. Requisites of a valid custom. Requisites of valid custom means the custom should be first reasonable, it should be consistent, it should be compulsorily be observed, it should be in continuity and immemorial antiquity and certainty. These are five requisites of a valid custom. Which are they? First, reasonableness means every custom must be reasonable. It should not be against the nature. It should not against the human life or life of society. Then consistency. It has to be followed consistently. There is no gap. There is no major breakup between the followers or observance of that custom. Then it should be compulsorily followed by all the people. Compulsorily observance by all the people, those who are binding by it. Fourth is the continuity, that it is not been break, and it may have the immemorial antiquity, or it is not within the knowledge of any person from where the custom has been started. And fifth one is a certainty. There must be certainty in the followance or observance of that custom. These are the requisites of valid custom. I hope this is clear to all of you. Reasonable means it must be reasonable, it must be logical, it must not be unnatural, it must not be against the life of any human being or the life of society as such. Then it must be consistently followed, compulsorily observed by every person. It is not optional whether to be followed or not to be followed. Second, or the next thing is it should have immemorial antiquity. Means in England, or the English law has fixed 1189 AD, the year of accession of King Richard I, as a good enough to constitute the antiquity of a custom. Whereas in India, there is no such year which has been prescribed to recognize a custom as a good custom. And the next or last thing is that certainty. The custom must have certainty. What exactly is to be done? It should be known to all the people. And therefore, when all these five ingredients are there in a custom or in a ritual, then that custom, that ritual, that usages will be considered as a valid custom. If any one of these is lapsed, then definitely that will not be considered as a good custom. It cannot be considered as a source of law. There is a defense, or there can be a claim that this cannot be a good custom as such. And therefore, to become a custom as a source of law, these five ingredients must be followed. I hope this is clear to all of you.